Hello everyone, and thank you for attending this webinar on pandemic economics, coping with the COVID-19 crisis. My name is George Papakonstantino, and I will be moderating this discussion. This is very much an extraordinary time for all of us. We are in lockdown, working from home, and deeply concerned about the huge human toll of the pandemic, but also about economic, social, and political implications. So it is in order to explore the questions surrounding this economic impact and economic response to the pandemic that the School of Transnational Governance of the European University Institute has organized this webinar. First, a word about the European University Institute, a unique international center for postgraduate studies and research in economics, law, social and political sciences, history, also home to the Robert Schuman Center for Advanced Studies and home to the archives of the European Union. Now, within the EUI, the School of Transnational Governance is a public policy school focusing on training and teaching governance beyond the state. You probably have watched just before we started a brief video with our new Masters in Transnational Governance that we're offering as of September. And today's a particular day for us because the new director of the SDG has been announced, Alex Stubb, former Finnish Prime Minister. Now, let me come to our two speakers today and thank them very much for being here, Richard Baldwin and Megan Green. Richard is a professor of international economics at the Graduate Institute in Geneva. He is the author of many books on the transformation of the global economy, but perhaps even more relevant for today's discussion, he has co-edited two instant e-books on the crisis, Economics at the Time of COVID-19 and Mitigating the COVID Economic Crisis, Act Fast and Do Whatever It Takes. Megan Green is Senior Fellow at the Harvard Kennedy School Mossavar Rahmani Center for Business and Government. She has been, over the last 15 years, a leading voice in global macroeconomics on both sides of the Atlantic. She is a regular contributor to the Financial Times and an analyst in international media. So thank you both for accepting to be here today. Now, some practical issues before we start. There are close to 500 participants that have registered through Zoom with a very broad geographical and sectoral spread. Some of you have already sent us questions when you registered, and we will be addressing these. Others that wish to pose questions during the discussion can do so through the Q&A button at the bottom of your screen. We will dedicate the last 20 minutes of the discussion in answering those questions, those that have not already been picked up by the two speakers. We're also live streaming on YouTube, so some of you may be watching via YouTube. So we will structure the discussion in four different blocks. First, speaking about the economic impact of the pandemic, then moving on to economic responses by governments, then speaking specifically about the EU level response, and then finally discussing the day after, the exit strategies and what our economies would look like after the pandemic is over. So let me start with the economic impact and start by saying that we all understand that there's this huge uncertainties in being able to figure out what the economic impact of this crisis is. And these uncertainties are linked to the uncertainties relating to the pandemic itself and its evolution. Nevertheless, it is clear that we're facing a very large shock, which comes both from the supply side, as global supply chains have been disrupted, as a lot of businesses have shut down, and on the demand side, as households are spending less and businesses as well. We seem to be looking at a recession that will exceed the one of a decade ago. In a sense, we have the mother of all sudden stops. So let me start with Richard and ask him if he could take us through the main factors which are determining the depth and the length of the economic crisis that we're facing. Richard.
Oh, thank you, George. We have a slide on this, and the answer is that it's an interaction between the medical crisis or the medical shock and the economic shock that's coming with it. So I'd like to draw your attention first to the medical thing, which is in the top panel there in sort of greenish yellow. You see the red curve there is a classic epidemiological curve, which is how epidemics go. They are hard to recognize at first, then they accelerate. That's what the United States is in. They peak, and hopefully that's what Europe's doing, and then they come down. China's gone through the entire red curve during that time. Now, any kind of pandemic on this size is going to cause a shock and cause some recession. And on the bottom panel there, the sort of bluish light blue, the dashed red line is an illustration of what the recession would look like if we just let the pandemic roar. But of course, if the pandemic is allowed to go, we'll see hospitals around the world overwhelmed as they were in Wuhan, as they are still being in Italy, as they are in Spain, and it's starting in the United States as well. Soon it'll be everywhere. In order to avoid overwhelming hospitals, our governments are undertaking these lockdown or containment policies in order to flatten the medical curve. So they're trying to push the red curve to the blue curve, which flattens it and stretches it out. But in doing that, they're keeping workers away from work and consumers away from consumption. And that's worsening the recession curve. As you can see, the blue dotted line is much deeper and longer. And that's because the containment policies, not the disease, are causing the recession. Now, we're going to come in maybe the next section to the economic policy, but the idea is that how long this recession lasts is to a large extent dependent upon the policy reactions that we're starting to see. We'll dig into that a little bit later, but that's that green arrow pushing the bottom blue curve back up towards the green curve, so it's not as deep as it otherwise would be and hopefully shorter.
So Richard, just one more question on this. Does that mean that there is a trade-off to be made between health and economic concerns, certainly in the short run, but how about in the longer run?
Well, so that's hard to know what's gonna go on. And it also depends upon the country. So there might be a very well direct connection if we didn't have these shield packages, these bailout packages. So what we want to do is avoid humanitarian crisis and unnecessary deaths by having the containment policies, but making sure that there's no long-term or as little possible long-term damage with the complementary domestic policies. So in that sense, there doesn't need to be much of a trade-off. There's evidence from a century ago, I don't know how much useful that is, but a century ago, some of the studies showed that in the 1918 pandemic, the cities that locked down fastest in the United States recovered better later on, but I'm not sure how relevant that evidence is. But right now we have a humanitarian imperative to prevent this kind of calamity that's going on in the hospital, unnecessary deaths. So we need the lockdowns. And now what we need is policies to make sure that things aren't worse on the economic side than need be.
Thank you. Megan, we've seen stock markets crash. We've seen the highest ever increase in job seekers in the US. Inevitably, the comparisons with the great financial crash of a decade ago are there. Back then, the US dropped 2.5% in 2009, the EU 4.5%, the world as a whole 2%, but China actually rose. So if we're comparing the two episodes, what should we expecting? And should we be expecting a sharp drop and a sharp uptake, so a V-shaped recovery, or is it going to be more a U-shaped or even a W-shape with a double dip?
Yeah, so I'll say there is no actual line in our macroeconomic forecasting models for a virus. So our modeling is pretty dodgy at best. And having lived through the 2008-2009 crisis, I'll also say I've never seen economists race to slash their forecasts as much as they have this time around. So every week, the banks are coming out with brand new forecasts for the contraction that we're going to have in the US, Europe, and abroad. And so, you know, in the US, you see forecasts now ranging from a contraction of 10% to a contraction of 40%, which is a pretty big range. And honestly, either one is entirely plausible. I think it will probably be somewhere in between. But that far outstrips what we saw in 2008, 2009. I think we'll see the same in Europe. And as you point out, during the global financial crisis, China was stimulating significantly. This time around, China's had to have a hard stop as well. And I think they'll stimulate significantly trying to come out of this, but they're coming out of this at a time when most of us are just going into it. And so that backdrop won't help Chinese growth either. So I would say we're going to have the mother of all recessions. I would say we're probably going into a depression, but you know, the difference between a recession and a depression isn't particularly important or useful here. So the contraction will be sharp for sure. We've put all of our economies on ice. The idea being just to try to deep freeze our economies so we can get through a couple of months of this sudden stop. And hopefully once we contain the virus, we can start to thaw our economies and go back to business as usual. Initially, most economists suggested that we would have a V-shaped recovery. So the idea was that this would only last a couple of months, perfectly healthy businesses would just need some bridge loans to get through this difficult period. Individuals might need a bridge loan as well. And then in a couple of months, when we thawed our economies, we could ramp right back up and just get back to it. I think increasingly, we're starting to realize this, first of all, might take longer than we expected, but secondly, that this might not just be a one-off deep freeze. So my colleagues at the Harvard School of Public Health have been leading the narrative on this, and they've suggested initially we just need an immediate lockdown to contain the virus, and that's probably right. But the assumption was then we would let everyone out and they could go back to work. And that's probably wrong, because what that would do would just be to take us back a month where many of us don't have immunity, but the virus is still out there. So if we went back to work, we'd just have a resurgence of cases. So now the narrative has shifted a lot. I think we're hearing a lot about intermittent isolation. And I think that's how this will go going forward, in that we'll be locked down. The number of new cases will drop, will flatten the curve that Richard talked about a little bit until we hit a certain number on the low end. And then they'll let us out and the number of new cases will rise again until we hit a certain threshold on the upper end. And so as not to overwhelm our health services, we'll be locked down again. And we'll just continue to do that and bounce between these thresholds in terms of new cases until most of us have immunity. So until there's herd immunity, and then we won't have to worry about it as much, or until there's a vaccine or a cure, which, you know, most estimates suggest are at least a year out. And that means that we'll have this kind of lockdown, release, and it will probably last a lot longer. So it could last 18 months easily, which means we're going to have a really sharp contraction. And then on the way up, I don't think it will be a V. I think it will be kind of, it'll look more like a Nike swoosh, I think. And the uptick will probably be really jagged as we lock down and release and try to get back to normal. In the UK, I know there's already talk of immunity passports. So if you get the virus and they can prove that you've had the virus, so the testing capabilities are better, and we can figure out even if you're over it, that you once had it, then you get an immunity passport and you can go back to work. I mean, these things are starting to become part of the narrative. So unfortunately, I think a V-shaped recovery, really unlikely. It'll probably take longer and be much more zigzagged as we try to gain herd immunity without overwhelming our health services.
Also, doesn't the fact that we've seen the virus move from China to Europe, with the US being the epicenter now, but we haven't still seen it in emerging markets, and this kind of lack of synchronicity, doesn't that also sort of go in the direction of your argument in terms of that will make it much harder for a coordinated sort of recovery of everyone coming out?
Yeah, that's absolutely right. So I mentioned that China is kind of it's ahead of us in terms of this virus. So China is starting to get back to work against a backdrop where the global demand is at a complete standstill. So that will make it harder for China. But you're right to point out that most of the emerging markets, aside from China, haven't actually gotten the full force of this virus yet. And they are getting the full force in terms of kind of shocks through the financial system. So the shortage of dollar funding and the appreciation of the US dollar has already started to hit a lot of emerging markets who have issued debt in US dollar. And so they're having more trouble financing that debt. Also invoicing trade has become more difficult, but the actual virus itself hasn't hit emerging markets yet. And of course, emerging markets for the most part have healthcare systems that aren't quite as well equipped as ours in the West, and I have to say ours aren't that well equipped for this either. So that suggests that as we are getting over this, and developed markets, emerging markets might be getting hit, and that will again reduce global demand. So to your point, I think it'll be in fits and spurts and will take much longer than a lot of people are thinking.
Okay, let's move us a little bit to the question of the economic response. And we've seen really across the world governments attempting to mitigate the worst, the bottom end of the curve that Richard showed through unprecedented fiscal measures, additional public investment in the health system, direct transfers to people, guarantees, tax referrals, rebates. So let me start with Richard. How should we judge the policy response at the national level in terms of its appropriateness, in terms of its size, in terms of its mix? Is it managing to recalibrate expectations of households and firms? Is it time more for monetary policy, or is it more for fiscal policy here?
Okay, so I have another PowerPoint slide. As you know, I'm an economist, so I'm powerless without PowerPoint. So I'm going to show you one more slide to kind of explain how I think about this. Now, this is a complicated diagram, but let me just talk you through it quickly. There's three big balls across the middle of it. And so let's just take the household one and the business one. This is a classic way an economy works. Businesses pay wages to households. Households spend that on stuff that the business makes, and the dynamo keeps going around. A standard recession is when people stop spending enough, so the businesses don't have enough business. And as a consequence, the way you make that work is you stimulate spending through either lowering interest rates or tax cuts or something like that. This shock is entirely different. So the government is on purpose shutting down the economy. So this flow from businesses to household and wages, that's being shut down by lockdown. Businesses are being closed. People cannot go to work. Some of us, professors, were lucky enough to continue getting paid, but lots of people aren't getting paid or not by as much. And since they're not getting paid, they're not spending as much. So firms don't have the demand in order to produce it. And on top of it, they don't have the workers to produce it. So that's two very direct shocks that we don't normally see. The banks, the financial sector, some of them are facing non-performing loans, people not paying on mortgages, that's under stress. And you have with the supply chain, since you need parts and components and some of those are shut down, you're getting shock from the supply chains, both domestically and internationally. So my point here is this is not one crisis. This is an economy-wide crisis. And then what we need to do is shield the firms during the lockdown so they don't go bankrupt, so they'll be there when we get back. Shield the jobs so then when the lockdown ends, we'll have jobs when we come back. Make sure that the supply chain networks stay in place. And then because some of these policies are so large, it actually threatens the sustainability of the debt of the governments themselves. And we have to make sure the governments don't go bankrupt, that this one crisis doesn't trigger a whole bunch more. So these packages you talked about, I like to think of it as a shield package, not a stimulus package. We're trying to shield our jobs, our banks, our jobs, and our networks, so they'll still be there. And the analogy I like is August in Europe. In August, most of the workers stop going to work, production falls, GDP on the production side plummets, but it's not a crisis because we come back in September, all the jobs are there, all the firms are there, the banks are working. And what these policies have to do is make sure that it will be there when we get done on the other side. So personally, I think they have the right idea that they're shielding the economy. It's probably big enough, but given how fast they threw it together, I think it's really quite good. And I'm talking about the rich countries. In the poor countries, it's a different world, but I'll stop there.
In the background, Megan, how would you judge the $2 trillion package of the US? And there's two particular issues that are also interesting here. Richard mentioned that one should protect jobs, and there seems to be a different approach to this in the US and the EU, with the US being more willing to allow unemployment rates to just go up and send cash checks, as opposed to most countries in the EU trying to shield the jobs in place. So how do you see that? And also a word about the income and wealth inequality in all of this. Do these packages manage to do something about that? Because presumably they're hitting, you know, the weakest are hit the most in the crisis.
Yeah, so there's a lot that's really good in the US package, I would say. You know, getting a $2.2 trillion package passed in the amount of time they did was actually really remarkable. The downside was it still took too long. So a lot of businesses went out of business entirely while we waited for the Democrats and Republicans to argue. And a lot of people lost their jobs as well. But just to give you a sense of the size, this $2.2 trillion package plus two others that had already been passed, it amounts to around 12% of US GDP, which is pretty huge, but it can also be leveraged up with money from the Fed through loans for small and medium-sized businesses in particular. And so if you leverage it up, it actually ends up being about 30% of US GDP. So the sheer size is gargantuan. And I think that this time around, the US has done a much better job of actually bailing out Main Street as well as Wall Street, unlike in 2008, 2009, when most workers and homeowners felt like they were just kind of left to foot the bill for the banks, and the banks were the only ones, the banks and the car companies were the only ones who were really rescued. So it's more balanced this time around, which is good. It means our policymakers have learned something. The idea though is to bridge the economy for roughly 2 months. So to provide loans to small and medium-sized enterprises, and they turn into grants if these small businesses actually keep their workers. So there is a slightly European piece in that in terms of trying to protect jobs and guarantee worker pay. There's a bailout for some of the bigger industries, so the airlines industry in particular, the car industry, auto industry will probably get something as well. And then there are a bunch of other pieces of the bill that support health services. But to give you a sense of the scale of the economic policy reaction compared with the health policy reaction, out of $2.2 trillion in this bill, only around $150 billion went to healthcare. Which is nothing. And I think that's been a really big mistake with this bill. So in the US and in the UK, there's been this kind of panicked all hands on deck response to the economic policy issue with a fairly relaxed response on the health policy issue. And that's like a comet coming careening towards Earth and us, you know, cutting interest rates and providing some bridge loans. All the stimulus in the world won't do any good or start a recovery as long as we haven't dealt with the health policy side of this. I think it's inevitable that we'll end up with more packages in the US and probably in much of Europe as well. Even though I highlighted the scale of this deal, I think a new package will have to be directed towards health policy. We'll need to get protective gear to those on the front lines of this, for example, beef up hospitals, try to support research for a vaccine, things like that. Also a big gaping hole in this bill was support for states. So all states except for Vermont have a balanced budget rule, and they're at the front lines of this. They're the ones who can actually target money towards the individuals and small businesses who need it. We don't really have great tools for that through the federal government or the Federal Reserve. So the states are really going to have to do it. But they're incredibly financially constrained now, and they're at the front lines of this. So we're going to need to provide more funding for states, certainly. And then I think we'll probably need more measures for individuals and businesses as this goes on. So this is definitely not the last bill that we'll see. There's reticence to try to pass anything without overwhelming consensus and agreement for it because of the TARP I deal in the last crisis, which did not pass and was a disaster. So that's a factor. And also actually a lot of congressmen have gotten the virus themselves and there's no real mechanism for remote voting. So as people don't want to travel to DC and as people don't want to be in a room with other congressmen who have gotten the virus, that could constrain passing more bills as well, in addition to it being an incredibly divided government. So we'll need more, but we'll see how much we can get passed. To your point about the approach to unemployment, the US has cut checks to people and beefed up unemployment insurance pretty significantly. And I think that both are good, actually. Cutting checks to people was to get money to those people who lost their jobs and, you know, had no money for rent or bills or food. It's not particularly elegant. It's not targeted, but the idea is that those people who need it will spend it right away, and those who don't need it will hang on to it until they can spend it, and that will boost a recovery on the other side of this. It's not enough money. So people who make up to $75,000 will get a check for $1,200, and those with children will get $500 checks in addition to that. But it is something immediate that we could do. We beefed up unemployment insurance as well, but we had almost 10 million people succeed in filing unemployment benefit claims in 2 weeks in the US. We've never seen anything like that. The chart looks like there's a big mistake in it, like you put in a wrong number because it just jumps up so spectacularly. So that's been the approach in the US. Europe, on the other hand, has really focused on keeping people in their jobs rather than beefing up unemployment insurance, so that on the other side of this, those people can go ahead and ramp back up work. They have the skills, they understand the culture of the company, so the recovery could be faster. There are benefits to that. You probably could ramp up faster, but it's a lot more expensive if the government is guaranteeing people's wages. And so, you know, we don't know which approach will be more effective. It all depends on how long this lasts. If it's a fairly short, deep freeze of the economy, then protecting people's jobs is the better approach. If it actually takes much longer, then protecting people's jobs is really expensive. And maybe it is better to actually let some of these people claim unemployment insurance. A lot of the businesses they were in are never coming back. And so allow them to kind of retool and reskill and move into sectors that will do well on the other side of this. So it depends on the length of this recovery. And then in terms of inequality, unfortunately, I think that this crisis will probably accelerate a bunch of things that were driving inequality to begin with. It's of course the hourly service workers with no clients to service anymore who are hit the hardest. And you know, in the US, they tend not to have benefits either. So they're the most vulnerable. And many of them have been laid off. You know, they're among the ranks of the 10 million who have already claimed for unemployment in the past 2 weeks. So it does hit the most vulnerable. It hits the young, those who are, you know, coming onto the job market now. It'll impact them now, but also, you know, if they finally find a job, they won't have much bargaining power for wages. So for their entire careers, they'll be starting from a position of being behind on wages. So it will affect them. It affects the elderly, of course, a lot. And then if I look, you know, across the street, I see all these independent shops that have shut their doors. A lot of them aren't coming back. They don't have access to capital markets because they're small. It's going to be the big multinational businesses like Starbucks who are going to go in there. And so there's been this huge trend towards market concentration in the US that'll be, and to Europe, to a lesser degree. And that's just going to be exacerbated by this as the big superstar firms can withstand this. And in tech, in fact, it's, you know, the big superstar firms are really going to thrive because they're digital. And so they're doing well off of this. And unfortunately, the more market concentration you have, the less bargaining power workers have on wages. So I think that will exacerbate inequality as well. So unfortunately, after wars, often inequality falls, partly because, you know, you have a lot of inflation. And so that inflates away the top 1%'s wealth, or you raise taxes massively to pay for rebuilding everything. This time around, it's different. I think with this pandemic, we don't have lots to rebuild this time around. And so I think inequality will probably get worse off the back of this.
Before we move on to the European response, I want to bring in Richard and ask him a question. A lot of the political economy discussion in the economic response is going to be about bailouts. So who should be bailed out and who would not be? So are we going to see bank bailouts, insurance funds bailouts in the way that we saw back in the global financial crisis?
Well, not quite. It'll be different, but so the trouble with the global financial crisis was it really hit the financial sector very directly. They had, through poor regulation, invested in things that all of a sudden went to zero. Whereas here, it's really loans to which aren't particularly bad, who might turn into non-performing loans. So in the United States, where lots of businesses are going bankrupt, many of those loans won't get paid off. And I suspect lots of homeowners won't be able to pay their mortgages, and people who own car loans, there may be a lot of non-performing loans, but that doesn't tend to be one of these tsunami things that where banks lend to each other and now trillions of dollars disappeared overnight. So I don't see a huge wave of bank failures. Moreover, the central banks around the world have gotten very good at keeping banks in business. And that's this really is a sort of situation where if you just carry the bank through till after we have a vaccine, then business will go back. Maybe it'll be slow, but there's no particular reason to have a wave of bankruptcies in the banks. And if we do, we have very specific tools to fix it. I think it's more the bankruptcy of small, medium enterprises. I think there's possibility of emerging market crises, governments going bankrupt. That's more what I would concern. I guess we're going to talk about that in a second.
Yeah, actually, this brings us to Europe in the sense that what we've seen in Europe is, aside from the national response with every government, including those that believed very much in economic orthodoxy announcing measures, the German unlimited guarantee to firms, for example. But what we have seen in particular has been the European Central Bank announcing a 750 billion pandemic emergency response program, purchase of assets. And if you add previous announcements, it's over 1 trillion. So we've seen that. We've seen national governments responding. What we've seen less is an EU-wide fiscal response. We've seen the European Commission discuss, and actually tomorrow is a Eurogroup and some discussions may be taken there, discuss a fund for short-term covering unemployment. We've seen some money from the EU budget, but there is a very robust discussion going on at the moment, whether to the extent that many of the countries that will be spending a lot have high debt levels, whether there will be a need for a more coordinated fiscal response. And let me start with Megan here and ask you, first of all, was the ECB response appropriate and adequate for the task? Can the ECB do it alone, or does the ECB need the help of a fiscal hand? And when we come to the fiscal, there's a discussion about the Eurobond or a more specific Corona bond, meaning more specific to the crisis and not mutualizing debt in a more general sense. So, and if we can compare the instruments now with the instruments that we used 10 years ago, the ones that we created back then, such as the European Stability Mechanism, are they appropriate to be used in the current situation?
Yeah, so I'll start with the ECB's response, which was pretty huge. Is 750 billion euros enough in this PEP QE program? Probably. If it's not, they're just going to re-up it and make it bigger. I think one of the most important things about it is that the ECB has kind of shaken off its reliance on the capital key in announcing the PEP. So the capital key is set up according to the size of an economy in Europe. Germany is the biggest economy, so the ECB can buy the most German bonds, then French bonds, and then Italian bonds, for example. But it's always been really beholden to that. And with the PEP, it gets a bit more flexible, particularly over time. You can buy lots of Italian bonds in the short term and then kind of even it out over the course of the program. So there's more flexibility baked into it. I wonder if that isn't a step towards something that would be far more effective, which is yield curve control, which the Bank of Japan is engaged in, that the ECB could never do because of the capital key. But if it's going to throw off the capital key, that becomes maybe a possibility, and it would be far more financially efficient. The ECB probably wouldn't actually have to spend much money at all if it announced yield curve control. So if it said, you know, we're going to keep Italian bond yields at a certain level and throw whatever money we need to at it. If it were credible, it wouldn't actually have to spend much money at all. The markets would just believe it. So that could be kind of a precursor towards something more effective. Also, I just want to highlight quickly that the TLTROs that the ECB announced are kind of a sleeper tool that I think is maybe a huge bazooka, because they've offered banks, the ECB's offered banks loans at, you know, deeply negative rates, more negative than the deposit rate if they extend those loans on to SMEs. So it's a massive subsidy for the banks, and they can cut that rate for the TLTRO deeply negative, much more than they have. And effectively, the ECB will just be paying for this stuff. But most people don't seem fussed about it, and it already exists and it's already legal. So that's a powerful tool. as well. So the ECB is not entirely out of bullets, even if it's normal ones of cutting rates, you know, probably have hit their limits of being useful. Is that enough? Definitely not. You need a fiscal response. And I have to say, in the last Eurozone crisis, I really just followed Europe. And this one, I follow the whole world. And it's so frustrating to watch the Europeans. I mean, fiscal coordination was never actually a strength at the EU level. And that's really coming out now. It does seem like the ESM is being considered as a major tool. Potentially, they can create credit lines. But they come with conditionality. And so what really concerns me at the EU level is the discussion of kind of moral hazard with a truly exogenous shock here. Moral hazard and conditionality should not come into it. If they can use the ESM, which is of limited size, but if they could make the only condition you have to spend this on coronavirus related stuff, that could be, you know, sufficiently flexible to work. But the concern is always that the ESM will come down with all kinds of conditionality once the immediate crisis is over and demand structural reforms. And I know the Italians are really worried about this and so less likely to actually look for that help. One way to leverage the ESM up is to use the OMT, which was a program announced by the ECB back in 2012, which says if you're in an ESM program, the ECB can actually spend lots of its money as well. But you have to sign up to strict conditions. So if they can make the conditions, just use this for stuff related to the coronavirus, that might be sufficiently flexible to be useful. Far more powerful would be, you know, Euro bonds or coronavirus bonds. But again, the discussion there, particularly among the Northern European states, is that they don't actually want to risk share that much. They don't think that that's a route they want to go down. So I don't think it's going to happen, but I think it would be the first best solution. In the absence of first best solutions, we have to go with second best ones along the lines of what I was discussing for the ESM. And then this reinsurance program really quickly, I think is maybe a precursor towards risk sharing, but it's loans, not grants. And so I actually think it's not as useful as some people are hoping.
Just a quick follow-up on the various versions of the Corona bond. There's also a proposal of nine countries, a kind of a coalition of the willing type. Could they go it alone and issue a corona bond themselves?
So technically they can, I'm not sure how investors or more importantly the ECB would kind of rate this Frankenstein credit, bond. Would the ECB have to use the capital key for those willing participants? How much of it could they really buy? That's the important question, given that the ECB is the lender of last resort. It's really unclear. And also, I think you would miss out on one of the benefits of issuing kind of this sort of Eurobond, which is that the Northern European countries have higher rated credits and are viewed as more trustworthy by the markets. And so rates would be lower if you had everybody involved. And I worry further down the line that if you go that route and you have some European countries say, we're gonna actually show solidarity and do this, but other countries don't, that could be kind of the first step towards breaking up the Eurozone more broadly. And that's not the direction that we wanna be going in.
Okay, question to Richard to wrap up this session and move on to the day after. As economists, when faced with situations where debts are very high in an area like the Eurozone, we speak of two issues. We speak of debt neutralization on one hand, or we talk about monetary financing on the other. So a situation whereby central banks simply buy all this excess debt and somehow retire it or convert it into fresh money. So the question is, are we going to see any of these two? Are we going to see both? None of the above? And what do we need?
Sure. So let me just...
And since you're answering this, also one of the questions we've had is, and what's the impact on inflation that we're going to be seeing as a result of all this?
Right. So in the short run, I think this is a very deflationary crisis. But basically what we're doing is restricting the supply side of the economy at the same time as stimulating the expenditure, or at least replacing some of the stimulus. So I think even in just the medium run, it has to be somewhat more inflationary. And also that would not be a bad thing because what we're really struggling with right now is deflation. So my guess is inflation is coming back, and lots of economists are saying that. partly because of the monetary financing, partly because you're trying to stimulate spending when you don't have the supply shock. So if you remember the last time this happened, the 73 and then the 75 crisis, there was a supply side shock to the economy. So it was less productive. But the US in particular tried to maintain the spending, and that led to inflation, first in 73 and then 75. I was in high school in 76, and I remember double-digit inflation in the United States. That was because there was a negative supply shock, but an attempt to maintain the spending. So I think we could see some of that again. On the spending, what's happened in war previously, so it's very clear, time-limited, huge increase in spending. So you had some countries kind of grew their way out of it. So if you stop adding to the debt, which is in the top of the ratio, but the bottom keeps growing, then you can converge down to a sustainable point. The second is the definition of sustainable will change entirely. So safe asset is a relative concept. So Megan just told us that the US is going to add, just with this bill, another 10% to their debt to GDP ratio, and probably it'll be much more than that when the time they get done. So what a safe asset looks like will be very different, as it does after every single war. So I think we'll have a mix of people trying to grow their way out of it, some sort of inflation. I hope, and I don't really expect to return to austerity, because that didn't work out well the last time. And I think people are not in that kind of mood. I think there will be, we'll talk about it a little bit more, but I think the sort of voters have realized that it matters who's running their country now, and the sort of lack of attention and flippant, why not take Trump sort of attitude, that's gonna go away. And as a consequence, the people won't allow sort of the extreme austerity that will lead it, push us into that. So I think we're gonna see some monetary financing and some kind of trying to grow out of it. Personally, I don't see how this thing ends without more inflation than we have now.
All right, now let's move on to the question of the day after, because at some point the pandemic will abate, eventually it will die out, or at least it will be transformed into some recurrent flu type of epidemic. The economies will recover, but they will be very different. So I'd like to explore some of these issues with you. And again, let me start with Richard this time. And I start with you because you've written a lot about sort of the robotics revolution and AI. And it seems that the only thing, apart from the food chain, the only thing that is actually working at the moment is digital. So, right, exactly, what we're doing at the moment. So have we all gone digital? How much these kind of move to digital means for working and for shopping, a trend that we've been seeing, how much will that be reinforced by the crisis that we're living? How much will remain? What kind of, is this a structural break in our economies and the way they function?
Ah, thanks. So as you alluded, I wrote a book last, did I mention my book? Did I mention I wrote a book last year? So called The Globotics Upheaval, in which I'm talking about how globalization going forward will be much more digital. And sort of talk about telemigration and stuff. So that's a little bit where I'm coming from. Now, the way I think about this is we've run a whole series of experiments on what works digitally and what doesn't. Some of those experiments succeeded and some failed. So what we've done is explore at hyperspeed, at an incredible scale, what we can and cannot do virtually. And there's no doubt in my mind that frontier will be further towards digital, but we will have also learned that some things really require face-to-face or are just so much easier, or people like it so much that we'll do more of that. So in my book, I'm in the longer run, I didn't think it would happen so fast, but I was basically arguing that the jobs that are left will be more local, but lots of stuff will be more digital, so that the average job will become more where you actually have to be face-to-face, because everything else will be done by telemigrants or by white-collar robots, software robots, that kind of stuff. So personally, I think we're gonna push it, but it's not like we're never coming back. I saw a great joke on Twitter, and it was kind of like a fake survey, like who's driving digital transformation in your company? And it was like the CEO, the chief technology officer, the IT department, or coronavirus. And everybody chose coronavirus, which is pushing digital transformations at hyperspeed. So there will be a transformation, but I still think lots and lots of stuff has to be face-to-face. So
does that also mean, for example, on a more prosaic level, that for governments, revenue streams will have to move much more to digital activity? We're going to be seeing more of taxes on digital. We're going to come out of this. Revenue systems will be completely decimated. And governments will be looking at for new sources of revenue, because some of this will be monetary finance, some of which may be mutualized, but we're going to be facing higher debts and deficits. So, you know, are we going to be moving more towards a wealth tax? Are we going to be moving more towards digital taxes or carbon taxes to be able to get these kind of new resources?
Well, the basic political economy principle in taxation is any goose that has feathers, you pluck it. And so wherever there is money to be taken, you put a tax on it. Trouble with digital is it's actually fairly hard to tax, simply because it's hard to know where it is. And in fact, if you look at value-added taxation in Europe, it's only recently they've started taxing services, because it's a little hard to know where it was produced and how much has been value added. So I think there will be some move towards digital taxation, just because that's where there is some resources, but I think it's particularly hard to get. Now, you mentioned wealth taxes. I think, you know, I live in Switzerland, where we have had a 1% wealth tax, annual wealth tax forever, and it works. I think you could easily go towards that. One of the things that Piketty talks about in his new book is how after wars, there are sometimes like a one-off solidarity tax. And in Germany, after the fall of the wall, they had this solidarity tax. And I suspect we'll get some solidarity taxes out of this, probably oriented towards wealth, probably very progressive. If you look what happened in the United States after 33, FDR raised the marginal tax rate on incomes to 95%. Of course, nobody paid it, but that was there. And all across Europe, the taxation, first of all, people got income taxes, the state got income taxes, and they became more progressive. So that's what I think we're going to have, a sort of wave of taxations of corporations and richer people and wealth.
And since we're on taxes, and also picking up on one, because I'm now picking on some of the questions we've had, given that the price of oil has dropped so precipitously in the last time, is this also, will this crisis actually provide new impetus for a carbon tax to ensure that we keep to the greening of the economy goal?
Well, so I don't know if you have any comments on that, Megan. I can just read between the lines and fall back on what I said. They're going to tax anything they can. And a carbon tax is one that was really on the margin and probably kept off the books by intensive special interest lobbying. And I believe that at the end of this, we'll have a much more populist government. A lot of people will be paying attention. And as happened after the Great Recession, there will be a lot of people thinking that there was a bunch of people who survived this crisis. Well, a lot of people will die. So that's one thing is different. Rich people, famous people, poor people, they'll all die. But the fact that the wealthy survived it better, I think will lead to a populist uprising. And I think we'll see a great increase in voting, because like my children, when they're 20s, they like, who cares? You know, it doesn't matter who you vote for. And I don't think anybody's going to be saying that at the end of this crisis, that it doesn't matter who's in government when these things happen. So I do think we'll have carbon taxes and other things like that, which were marginally acceptable, but kept off by special interest groups.
Megan, can you pick up that point? And also, there's been a few days ago, a remarkable editorial on the FT about the need for a new social contract. And there's a number of questions that have come in talking about, is capitalism as we know it finished? Have the structures and the underlying agreements, the tacit agreements that are there, no longer fit for purpose?
Yeah, so I agree with Richard that we're gonna tax everything we can possibly tax, with the exception of a wealth tax, which I don't think they tend to work or be worth it because they're so expensive to administer, but a digital tax, the carbon tax, I think those are probably coming. I also think we're looking at a much larger role for the state in our society, much larger than we, you know, ever expected. I know people in IT sectors who are shopping around apps to Western governments so that you can, in real time, as they have in China, look at your app and see who has the coronavirus and exactly where they are in relation to you. Now, that's that's an invasion of privacy that no one would have considered, you know, even a month ago in the West. So I do think that some of these privacy concerns are going to come to the fore, but that we're all going to accept that the government's going to have to do a lot more. In the US, you know, the real weaknesses in our health services have been laid bare by this crisis. And so I do think there could be, you know, more conversations about, you know, how we support those who aren't employed, don't have benefits, things like that. I don't think we'll get to an NHS type system here, but it was out of World War II that NHS was born. It was out of World War I that council flats in the UK were born. Social Security in the US came out of the World War. So, you know, stranger things have happened than that we've had these huge jumps in a bigger role in government towards supporting those who are most vulnerable. And it's quite possible that we'll get a jump this time around as well. In terms of globalization, I would say that we're looking at every state in it for themselves all of a sudden, even in Europe to some degree. And so I think globalization in a physical sense will decrease off the back of this, but I think globalization in a digital sense will increase pretty massively. I mean, I've done a million webinars on Zoom. There are aspects of them that actually are much better than having webinars in real life. More people show up. It's easier to moderate the questions. We're discovering that some of this stuff actually works, and it'll totally change our workforce, I think. You won't have to live in a big city necessarily in order to do your job. So that opens up all kinds of opportunities in lots of different countries. And I also think we're learning how to do much more with fewer resources. So off the back of this, we could get a productivity boom, and we've had, you know, frustratingly weak productivity growth for the past decade. So that could shift as well and also push inflation, to Richard's point too. So, you know, everybody's arguing we'll have much less globalization because everyone's in it for themselves, but I actually don't think that's strictly true. We'll just have a different kind of globalization.
Richard, do you agree with this? Because, okay, it's clear the digital aspects of globalization will be increased, but Megan makes a point here that the physical aspect will be less than before. So we've seen the disruption of the global value chains. Are they going to be reconstructed, or are we going to be seeing governments increasingly sort of keeping a bigger part of production internally, fearing that these chains kind of let them hanging in crisis situations?
Well, so I think that's the learning right now, but I think it's wrong. I think basically the trade and globalization is an enormous insurance policy, or to put it more boringly, a risk pooling policy. And I think people in the United States will very soon be very happy that China's still trading with them, because they'll be providing protective equipment for the doctors and respirators. And because China's industry is coming back online when the US industry is going offline, globalization is going to allow many people, many Americans, to be saved. So I think the logic of this is, don't put all your eggs in one basket, even if that basket is domestic. So global supply chains that are fragile and narrow and over-focused, I think we'll move away from that. But the solution is not to bring them all at home. Because think about if the United States industry did not have access to the productive capacities of, say, Korea and China and Japan right now, they would be in much worse state. And the same with the other way. When China was shut down, they could import. So I think they're actually for broader globalization. The lessons here, both on food and medicine, will be that we need to diversify our suppliers, not just bring them all home. The other is, I think, to a certain extent, this is like one of the few times in history when almost all humans on the planet have experienced the same thing at the same time. And this time, it wasn't a war. There was no human responsible for this sort of thing. So I do think that when we get through this, there will be kind of a kumbaya coming together moment. Right now, we're all tearing each other apart for N95 masks. But pretty soon, I think people will realize that we actually needed countries as the waves of viruses go through and shutdown policies become intermediate, that we will need each other. Moreover, I think there will be, especially when the death rate gets high enough, so most people will have known somebody who suffered severely from it, I think it will come home that everybody's together. So personally, I am an optimist, but I think that this will help global cooperation on trade, on climate change, lots and lots of other things. And I think some of the people who've played on the hateful feelings of the foreigners or xenophobia, I think they'll be out of office because for whatever reason, they've all been very incompetent about dealing with this policy. So personally, I think globalization will advance, but I liked Megan's physical potentially down, especially in medical equipment. I guess everybody's gonna want some of that at home, but digital will definitely go up. So I could think about that.
Okay, let me stay on the international cooperation aspect because we have a number of questions on this. And it seems that a lot of the participants in this are coming from continents outside the EU and the US. And there's a lot of questions on what the crisis means for emerging markets in terms, are we going to, for example, be seeing a string of sovereign debt defaults in these countries? What will the IMF be able to do or other multilateral institutions to help? So Megan, can I go with this on that, with you on that?
Sure. So I do think that there will be a series of sovereign debt crises in emerging markets, but also I think there will be a series of debt crises in the private sector in emerging markets as over the past decade, increasingly it's been corporates who have been issuing US dollar denominated debt in emerging markets more than it has been sovereigns actually. In terms of international cooperation, the IMF has said that they have funding available. Of course, it's not enough. They need to raise SDRs, I think, to be available for IMF programs. The World Bank can also be involved in providing funding, but also technical support. But I think that's kind of the best we've got. And for years now, we've been asking whether the Bretton Woods institutions were actually relevant anymore, whether they had the right tools. Broadly, the consensus has been that actually, no, they don't. They don't have enough money. The IMF doesn't reflect, you know, the gross weighting of emerging market countries, which has increased a lot. I think that's all true. But in this sense, I think the IMF is pretty much going to have to be the center of any kind of coordinated response in emerging markets. And right now, it's definitely not big enough. But they can raise SDRs to get more funding to deploy that.
Okay, well, we're coming to the end, but I have one more question which I'd like to ask to Richard. Until now, in the last decades, we've lived with this sort of competition between economic blocks, the EU, the US, China. And we've seen the ascendance of China in many ways challenging the global governance system as we've known it. We've seen the US become almost a disruptor in that system under the current administration. This crisis is one of those points that it changes a lot of things from policies to attitudes. It leaves behind some sour taste in terms of where the crisis originated, the lack of cooperation between governments. Even within Europe, we've seen in the beginning of the crisis some export bans, for example, of critical equipment. So, how is the relationship between these three blocks going to develop going forward, given this crisis?
Sure. So let me, since I have like 3 minutes to do this, I'm going to be just assertive and hark back to what happened in the 1930s in the Great Recession, US versus USSR, and after the war, 1945, US versus USSR. The learnings from then is that communism was working well. And 20% of the French and Italian populace started voting for hardline Soviet-oriented communism because it worked, because they survived the Great Recession better, and they did reasonably well in World War II. I think we'll have a similar thing between US and China. China will come through this looking better than the US. So I think there will be some shift towards thinking that the Chinese model, which is a communism with Chinese characteristics, has more attractive features than the US oriented. I think that will be a one-off shock that will be hard to resist. And China, as you can see, is playing it very well with sending masks and respirators around and things like that. So I do think that the US is gonna take a one-time ratchet down and China is gonna take a one-time ratchet up. I don't think it'll change the EU much.
Any last comment very briefly on this, Megan?
Yeah, so I would say look at the narratives that are being spun, particularly by the US and China. In China, there's the conspiracy theory that this was all actually biochemical warfare by the US. That's how this started. In the US, you know, the last G7 foreign ministers meeting couldn't produce a communique because Pompeo from the US was insistent on calling it the Wuhan virus rather than the coronavirus. So I just think this suggests that it'll cause both of us to retreat back into our corners in a competition for power. So the trend that we've been on for a while will just be exacerbated, I think.
And I would like to think that in this US-China rivalry, the EU will have a role to play, and a bigger one than it does at the moment. But that will be for another time. I want to thank you both very much for participating in this. And I want to thank everyone who has joined us. Hopefully it's been an interesting discussion. Thank you all very much.
Thank you.
Thanks.